comes a point in our lives when we have to choose between two paths. The first, to take the job that pays the bills, or to risk it all and follow our dreams.
Our next guest had to make that choice. On one hand, he was a young lawyer who made a great salary, but at the same time, his dream was to be far from the office and in the poorest part of Dallas, Texas.
As a second-year lawyer, I'd been working in Dallas for a couple of years. My wife and I were fully engaged in our church, but I really had a desire to be giving back to our city. And so I began volunteering over in West Dallas by mentoring a fourth-grade student. About that same time, we were able to begin volunteering with the missions conference.
PCPC held a missions conference, and at the end of the conference, Skip Ryan gave an altar call about anybody who is interested in praying through going to the mission field.
My wife and I looked at each other and said, this is what we need to be doing, even though it was scary. I'd still been mentoring over in the inner city, and it was one afternoon that I was traveling across the Hampton Bridge from West Dallas over into the North Dallas area. And it just dawned on me, really felt the Holy Spirit convicting me that this was the mission field that God was calling me into.
Doors just flew open, really, one after the other. The Lord made it so clear that Dallas is where we were supposed to be.
All I knew at this point was that I'm a lawyer willing to take my law degree over into the inner city. And so started doing a lot of research, visiting with a lot of people, both outside the community, with inside the community. And it was at that point that I really saw the need. I saw that there were hundreds of drug houses, abandoned properties, these kinds of situations where there was a lot of crime. What if lawyers in Dallas were able to come together to help reduce the crime in the community? That would be something that would be very transformational. And so started figuring out, where is the crime? Well, it happens oftentimes, even starts with these drug houses or these abandoned derelict properties. And so by mobilizing volunteer attorneys and representing inner city residents who have said enough is enough, and coming alongside community leaders in the city of Dallas, we're able to hold the owners of these crime-ridden properties, these drug houses, these abandoned homes accountable. And so really that's how ACT came about. Our vision is to see the transforming presence of Jesus Christ in this community experienced by these residents through safer, more stable neighborhoods.
I have lived in West Dallas all my life. I loved it, except for the past 15 years, and then it got real bad with the drug houses, and especially when they're right across the street from you.
A drug house that had been used for drug sales.
Drug dealers start living in the house. Ladies of the night, it was 24/7, daytime, evening time, nighttime, all the time.
As we began learning about this property and getting to know Ms. Cooper, she became one of my heroes because she was a bold advocate for her neighborhood and her street.
My house was broken into four different times. They had guns. I did not want to walk out at night. They would run across the street. Can I get $2 or $3 from you? They was just throwing the trash in the yard. A terrible odor coming from the house. The odor from the house was prostitution. And I was just glad when ACT came in and start working with it and got rid of them.
Although we ended up having to file suit on Ms. Cooper's behalf, that lawsuit was all that was needed to light a fire underneath these owners.
I did not know my legal rights. I didn't know what to do, but I knew God was going to take care of that place.
The children on that street are no longer confronted by drug dealers and prostitutes. You don't hear the gunfire. It really is a new street. One owner had left his old, abandoned, boarded up, rat-infested property there for the last 15 years. We ended up representing two families that lived next door who again said they were tired of living next to this home, a home that would have weeds that in the summertime would grow up waist high. So much rat excrement, sexual activity going on behind the house, a constant source of fear.
Por el miedo, por todo lo que me mantenía dentro de mi casa.
And so what we were able to do is bring a local law firm in to represent these two women and their families.
I think one of the most powerful moments for me as a lawyer was walking into her house with Reed and his team and telling her that we finally won demolition. And you can just see kind of a wave of relief go over her. And to think that her kids and her family no longer need to live next to this property and can feel safe, it was really beautiful to be a part of that moment with her.
Pues feliz, pues que ya no voy a tener miedo, que ya voy a estar libre.
Today we're demolishing a house that's been a nuisance to this community for the last 15 years. It's a huge, huge day in terms of justice being brought to West Dallas.
We had an amazing day when we actually demolished this home. Over 50 volunteers from all over Dallas, outside the community, inside the community, came together.
But now, God, something new would take place. You say, I have not seen God, nor ears heard the things prepared for your peoples, dear Heavenly Father.
Over 50 volunteers spent time actually taking down this house board by board.
The community has changed over the last 2 years drastically. 2 years ago, we had approximately 10 to 12 crime-ridden properties. Now, we're down to two or three crime-ridden properties in our community. Prostitution is next to none, almost, in our property, whereas 2 years ago, you could see prostitutes walking up and down Westmoreland. Now, the properties that are being demolished alleviates a lot of that.
Up until this point, we've been able to represent over 20 families in order to shut down 6 drug houses and address 10 abandoned, dilapidated homes. Crime has actually been reduced in the 2 neighborhoods that we've been working in by 30%, which is just a huge blessing.
The Holy Spirit works in mysterious ways. Never would I have thought that, you know, a young lawyer would come from North Dallas to West Dallas to have a heart to help the people of West Dallas.
It's been such an amazing privilege to get to see the Lord take the faithfulness of Reed and carry it through with ACT. And it really is such a privilege to get to watch Reed do what I know that he really loves and what the Lord is really working through.
Christ was this quintessential act of justice. As lawyers and other people who care about justice, we have this amazing platform to be able to develop relationships with men and women and to be able to share with them about how we physically can free them from oppressive forces like crime, like urban blight, and then use that as a platform to share the gospel.
Well, joining us now is one of my heroes, the founder of ACT, Reed Porter. Reed, welcome to 700 Club Interactive.
Gordon, it's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me.
You are a second-year lawyer. You are on the career track. I assume you're trying to make partner and hit the American dream, yet you quit it all, you left it all to go help the poor. Why?
You know, for a number of reasons, I was actually humbled by watching that video again. But, you know, mentoring a fourth-grade boy in the inner city really gave me the opportunity to really start understanding what it was like to live in the inner city. And, you know, from there, I was able to start studying what the Bible says about the biblical mandate to pursue justice on behalf of the poor. And with those things in mind as a young lawyer, the idea of making partner, the idea of billing the most hours, just didn't resonate with me as much. And in fact, the opposite thing started happening, which was kind of an agitated spirit in my soul. And so began really praying through what that would look like, and actually had a situation happen one spring where I was waiting for my wife. She had just attended a funeral, and I was a little bit early to pick her up. And I had an opportunity to actually sit down on the lawn in this beautifully manicured area and start reading all these tombstones of the people that had died and were buried there. And one thing happened to me that was really interesting. I started looking at these names, and I started wondering, what have these men and women done in their lives? What legacy did they leave? You know, were they believers? Did they bring about God's redemptive plan on this earth? And I had what Henry Blackaby calls a crisis of belief, which, you know, really requires faith and action. And the verse came to me from James chapter 4, which says, you know, what is your life? You know, it's just a mist, here today and gone tomorrow. And I was convicted that my life was so short that I needed to be doing exactly what God was calling me to do. And really, making a long story short, you know, my wife and I started knocking on doors internationally, and those doors shut, as was told by my wife on that video. And it wasn't until I was driving across the Hampton Bridge that it dawned on me, the Holy Spirit really placed in my heart this desire to go into the inner city, go into the place that had been in my backyard the entire time, to actually do something that would be systemic and transformational. And that's really how the ACT model got developed. We started, you had a lawyer, a young lawyer who had decided to take his law degree into the inner city. And thankfully through the Holy Spirit, I was convicted to start researching the best model to go about that. And we found out that there was all of this crime in the inner city, and it was crime that started on these single family homes. And so we found out that there was actually a law in the state of Texas, as well as around the nation, that would allow us to hold the owners of these drug houses and abandoned properties accountable. And so really the model for ACT was created. It was an opportunity for us to come into a neighborhood, represent inner city residents, mobilize volunteer lawyers who wanted to use their law degrees for furthering God's kingdom. And then we had an opportunity at that point then to use justice then as a platform to share the gospel.
You talk about it being a model. You're trying to replicate this, aren't you, so that you can have lots of advocates for community transformation across the nation, right?
You know, I would love to be able to do that. You know, God has placed a big vision on my heart for ACT. We really do feel like we have a great model that can not only be used in the neighborhoods that we're serving in now, but in other areas of Dallas, and then we hope to take it to other areas, other cities in the United States.
What I love about it is that you really have thought it through, that you really have, let's hit at the systemic problem and what's the best way to get in there and do the transformation. It's a whole lot more than a handout, and it's even a whole lot more than a handout. You really are trying to transform neighborhoods. How can people get involved if they see what you're doing and say, okay, I've got that in my town? How can they get involved? What can they do?
Sure. I think one of the biggest things for people to do is if they're wanting to pursue justice in their community, however that happens, you know, it's really important to start looking at your own life and just seeing how you are doing justice in the day-to-day events of your life. If you go back to scripture and you look at even like Old Testament passages from places like Job, in Job chapter 29, he says, you know, that he wore justice as his robe and his turban. And really what that is an opportunity to fully be about justice in every aspect of your life. Tim Keller has preached and spoken about this in a lot of his material over the last few years and really has resonated with me. But, you know, if we're a Christian and we're just going to church on a regular basis and perhaps we think we're not murdering or we're not using profanity and we feel like we're leading a pretty good Christian life, but yet we're not treating our employees with the right due that they're owed, then we're truly not living out a righteous life as Christ would want us to live. And so that's kind of the first step. And I think the second step would really be starting to look for those people in your community that have been wronged, those individuals who are without a voice. You know, Proverbs also speaks about saying, you know, speak up for those without a voice, for those, for the rights of all who are destitute. And so, you know, it's important to be looking around in your city. Where are the invisible people? Where are those that don't have the power, the influence, the resources, the connections that perhaps we have as believers, and who are being wronged in some way or who are being abused? And if you find those folks, then God has led you to exactly who you need to be looking to bring about justice and then ultimately the gospel to those families.
How has your work in Dallas been received by the local community, by the government?
You know, we've been truly humbled by the way both the local government and the community have come alongside us and supported this vision that God has placed on my heart. We've developed a strong relationship with the Dallas Police Department, other areas like other departments like code compliance and the city attorney's office. In fact, without the work of the city, we wouldn't have as strong a cases as we have. I've also been very humbled by the men and women that have been very receptive to this idea of, wow, I actually have a legal right to do something in my neighborhood, to bring about change, to bring about transformation. You know, I no longer have to feel imprisoned in my own home. My children can ride their bicycles up and down the streets. I want to get involved. You saw a couple of the stories on the video, Elma Canales and Doretha Cooper, two of my heroes. Those two women in two different situations both stood up for what they believed in, even at the risk of retaliation. And it was just a point in time when I see families that are willing to do that, it just is truly humbling, and it's by the grace of God that this is working.
Well, Reed, thank you for being with us. You're one of my heroes, and may God establish the work of your hands. If you want more information on Reed and the work of ACT, all you got to do is go to 700clubinteractive.com and we'll refer you over to him. You can be an advocate. You can be an advocate in your own neighborhood for community transformation. Just start understanding the rights that you have and be like Job, wear justice as a robe. Terry, over to you.
Still ahead, a city so impoverished that the Egyptian government hid it from the world. Find out how life changed for its people right after this.
It's hard to believe it's been 8 years since I made that commercial. And now I'm a 10-year survivor.
Today's a special day, a big milestone to me. I'm out here riding my horse, appreciating every minute of it.
My life changed the day I was diagnosed with cancer. It was hard when I was lying in the hospital and didn't know if anybody survived pancreatic cancer. That I decided,
if I survive this, I want to offer hope to somebody else.
And to show them that there are people out there like Cancer Treatment Centers of America who can make a difference.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and late-stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans.
The doctors looked over what they needed to do for me, but the decision was always mine.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, every resource, every one of us, everything we do every day is focused on you, our patient, your treatment, your healing, your survival.
After cancer now, I just appreciate life so much more. I appreciate the little things.
Being able to carry a bucket of water for my horse again was like winning a marathon. Not 1 hour goes by that I don't stop and think about how fortunate I was to have found CTCA.
Our teams of physicians, clinicians, and nurses are highly experienced and dedicated. We use state-of-the-art technology and give you innovative treatment options you may not even know exist. You'll also experience whole-person compassionate care here, unlike anything you've seen before.
When I talk to people, they said, oh my gosh, a 10-year survivor, I can't believe it. Life is good, and I just appreciate it totally. I'm doing things I never dreamt I would do.
Call or go to cancercenter.com today to learn more about our unique approach to state-of-the-art cancer care. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
The riots across Egypt made headlines around the world. And when the government lost control, Operation Blessing was there to help a forsaken community.
On the outer edge of Egypt's capital city, men, women, and children live and work in a garbage dump community called Esbet El Nahal. The streets are narrow and overflowing with piles of trash that horses and donkeys have brought from the city. Workers use their bare hands to sift through that trash, looking for items to recycle. The smell is unbearable. Before the revolution that removed Egypt's president from office, this community was a carefully guarded secret. The government didn't want the world to know about it. But now, all that has changed. The people here are mostly Christian, people like 27-year-old Magda. She lived in the garbage community for 18 years, but said that wasn't their greatest challenge.
Many women are not educated. Circumcision of young girls is very common. I think this is the greatest area of terrorist activity in Egypt. And we as Christians are suffering because of that. They keep us from going out. We're not allowed to go to our churches or our schools.
Magda lives with her family and thousands of others in these unfinished buildings at the dump, so there's no escape from the stench and filth when they return home from a hard day's work. Most in this community suffer from skin diseases, bronchitis, asthma, and other respiratory illnesses. With little money and few doctors, medical care is a luxury few can afford. That's why Operation Blessing decided to send medical teams into the community on a regular basis to care for the residents. And to help young women like Magda confront a culture that has made them into second-class citizens, Operation Blessing supports a ministry called King's Daughters, also known as KD. Here, the staff provides physical and spiritual care to hundreds of young women and teenage girls. They also provide counseling, education, spiritual guidance, and skills training. For Magda, being a part of KD has meant finding hope.
I had no relationship with the Lord before I joined KD. When I joined, everything changed. This is what the Lord wanted for me.
If you're a member of the 700 Club, thank you. You're part of that. You're part of transforming people in a slum in Egypt. If you're not a member and want to join in with everything we're doing, we're a lot more than a TV show. We want to reach out around the world with hands of love and compassion to let people know God loves them. He doesn't want to leave them in a trash dump. He wants to take them from the ash heap and make them princes. And you can be a part of it by joining the 700 Club. Call us now. The number's toll-free, 888-777-1999. How much is it? It's just $20 a month. That's just 65 cents a day. And you join with tens of thousands of people that want to make a difference in the world, that want to be a part of transforming lives one at a time, and you can join with us. When you call, ask for Pledge Express. That's electronic monthly giving. The bank does all the work. There's no checks to write, nothing to mail in. We save so much on the processing we can send as our gift back to you, Power for Life monthly teaching CDs. So if you like them, ask for Pledge Express when you call. Well, up next, a woman survives after her entire family is murdered. Her unforgettable story of forgiveness from the killing fields of Rwanda. After this.
It started as a way to provide groceries for the working poor.
We're helping to provide for over 10,000 people every week.
But it soon took on a life of its own.
There's a couponing class, there's a canning class.
Then we have raising chickens along with our gardening classes.
Go inside this revolutionary food pantry.
We have an exit strategy. We just embrace them till they're back on their feet.
On the 700 Club, next.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
Nothing can prepare you for the story you're about to see. It's torn from the pages of recent history and describes acts almost too barbarous to believe. But it happened. And the woman who survived it has become a living testimony to the power of forgiveness.
April 6, 1994, marked the beginning of one of the bloodiest chapters in Rwandan history. After Tutsi rebels assassinated Rwanda's president, the government responded brutally with the genocide of an estimated 800,000 people, most of them civilians.
My name is Aline. I was 16 when the genocide began in Rwanda.
It was very scary. It was very sad. We did not have hope.
Armed with machetes and guns, government soldiers went from house to house looking for traitors.
Every minute they kill people. During that time, that's when our mom told us to pick up what we need, different clothes, because we didn't want the people to come during night to kill us.
Eileen and her family fled their village in the early morning hours. Her mom stopped to help a neighbor and said she would catch up with Eileen and her younger siblings later. Soon after, Eileen witnessed the unthinkable.
That's why we started to hear the noise of guns. They shoot one person, die. You see another person die, another person die there. Then that's why I saw women were running. They start to save their lives. They leave their little kids. You hear kids crying on the street. Baby, 1 year, 2 months, 3 months, because the people run to save their lives.
Hours later, Eileen still hadn't seen her mother.
That's why I started to be desperate. I started to see at 6 p.m. normal, only see bodies. I started to think, I think she died.
Eileen found out later that her mom had been murdered. But to stay alive, she and her siblings had to keep moving. They hid in different houses until finally they found a refugee camp. But even there, they weren't safe.
During the camp life, the camp's life was bad. We are killing each other. So anytime we waited to die in the camp.
After only 3 months, the conflict was over. Eileen returned home with her siblings and took in a family whose house had been destroyed. But the family wanted Eileen's property for themselves. One day, when Eileen was away, the family killed her brothers and sisters.
They killed them.
Eileen knew that if she didn't leave, she would be next. So she went on the run again with no idea where to go. She ran into an old classmate whose family took her in.
It was a good family. They are wealthy. They have everything. We used to go to the lake. They have money. But we lost over 75 members of my family alone. And I was angry at that time also for losing my people that had the spirit of bitterness in me.
Eileen bonded with the girl's mother, Sylvia, who told her about Jesus. Soon, Eileen began going to church and accepted Christ as her Savior. But she was still bitter toward the people who murdered her family. She tried again and again to forgive, but couldn't.
Every time I go to the church, I speak about the forgiveness. And I say, what about the people who have killed my family, my siblings? The people who burned my mom alive, the people who cut my families into pieces, who crushed my siblings with the stone and crushed their head like a snake.
But Eileen says she finally found a way to forgive them when she read a verse in the Bible.
I used to think I'm the one who was right. They were wrong. Until I read Matthew 6, verse 14 to 15, if you don't forgive others, God will not forgive you too.
Eileen says afterwards God gave her a peace she never had before. Today she's a missionary and a preacher. She believes that no matter what has been done to you, Christ can help you forgive.
After forgiving those people completely, I started to help other people. It's like a joy came in my life. It's like I have a joy inside in me and compassion. Before I didn't even have compassion. And today I help the people around the world, different nations. Jesus set me free.
That's what he came for. The Bible says Jesus came to set the captive free. That's why he talks about forgiveness. Forgiveness doesn't mean that you're saying what was done unfairly is wrong or is right or okay. It means you're saying, I choose to be obedient to God and to forgive people so that the bitterness and the resentment don't hold me captive. God wants us to be free, free to love others, even as we're free to receive His love. If you've had something difficult happen in your life and you've had trouble forgiving, call the number that's on your screen. It's 1-888-777-1999. There's a friend on the other end of that line who would love to pray with you today. Reach out to the Lord and let His mercy and grace fill your heart and bring you healing and wholeness. Let Him let you be set free. Well, we leave you today with this from the word, from the book of Psalms 145. The Lord is merciful and compassionate, slow to anger, and filled with unfailing love. God bless you. We'll see you next time.